What a crashed guys on the previous battle. I don't know why.
my father?
What's this? I found something. Lucky find. Nice.
Thank you. Look out! I see a trap nearby.
I've spotted something. Careful now. That's a trap. Strange witchery is this.
Thank you. Oh, that Ma. What's a disfigured slave doing in my lair? Come on, slave. Show me your...
tits!
How funny that you'd think I'd answer to a lizard's pet. That's what your scar means, doesn't it? You do tricks on command and sleep in a kennel, isn't that right? Why don't you bark for me, elf? Go on. Bark. Toodle. Oh, look at you. Tell me, Becca. Ha! You're cute when you think anyone should take you seriously. Give them my regards. Oh, I really don't feel like chatting now. Give them my regards. You're embarrassed. Gone tomorrow.
An illusion.
Life's a dream.
This fellow must be quite proud of himself.
Didn't I tell you to leave? Wasn't I clear that you're not welcome here? You can't teach a fool anything.
Thank you.
this again.
And you thought Rivelon was flat?
A conundrum. What's it you'll have to solve? I thought you looked clueless, all right? Thing is, it's about the letters, isn't it? One for each thing. Easy. Yeah, sure. Hope you don't die. Well, nice to meet you too, rude thing.
You come to find. You come to search. But you won't find the way. A pity. I cannot help you. I only give the questions. I do not answer them. Braccus has willed it. Trompnoy must abide. You have met the unfortunate guardian of this vault. Fate has been unkind to Trompdoy, and so has Braccus Rex. Do you wish to move forward? Listen closely and make your attempt. Braccus is a bloody, rotten, thieving, very, very awful fellow. Some even call him a cur. A cur is... Either you're very good at guessing, or the slightest bit clever. Let's find out for certain. Listen closely, and make your attempt. Source is a scourge, a devil, a misery, a blight, a hex, a curse. And yet, the cure is... Perhaps you're not totally incapable after all. Or maybe Trompdoy told you the answers, is that it? Is he hoping you'll... It doesn't matter in any case. The path is open. Go freely. I know little, but you have proven yourself a knowing traveller. I will answer what I can. Braccus Rex has charged him, tried him, convicted and punished him. I know not the crime, but he has been sentenced to remain in this vault for all time and to prevent others from entering. Trompdoy was and is a creative man. He knew petty magic in his day, but this he has used to carve this place out from a simple vault, myself included. Braccus Rex discovered the way. This he researched here, upon this isle. He could remove the source from any creature or individual. I saw the staffs he used myself. They were most impressive.
You see yourself in the mirror. It's quite a sight.
Thank you.
As you pick up the ring, you feel a cold, dark pain shoot up your arm. Your mind itches. You don't hear, but feel a whisper in your ear. It tells you to slip the ring onto your finger.
What do you want? Well, it takes one to know one, mate. But it's a riddle, isn't it? A conundrum, what's it? I thought you looked clueless, all right? Thing is...
Yeah, sure.
Well, nice to meet you.
That's plenty. Comes with inner source.
You made it all this way.
He trembles and seems to shudder with a quiet sob.
I'm cursed, you know. Bloody Braccus bound me here to protect his vault. He has my soul in that jar just there, and I can't leave without it. As long as the jar stays unbroken, I can never truly die. I don't rightly know. This was the Source King's way. Befriend you, then destroy you. I was a fool to expect I'd be an exception. His favor was intoxicating. That's no excuse, but it is the reason. Really? You would?
He drops to his knees before you and grabs onto your feet with both hands, head hanging.
Thank you.
Nice.
Thank you.
The soul jar stands on its plinth, glowing softly. From within, you can almost hear the whisper of a voice. You see, or rather, you feel, a far-off land. Frozen breath hangs in the air, pine needles brush your cheeks, and in your arms, you can feel a weight, a body, dead. But you have hope. Your vision swims. You're older, but perhaps not wiser. You march at the head of a shambling host, the enemies of Braccus Rex melting before you. The scene twists again. Now Braccus stands before you, a beautiful woman at his side. You lash out in treasonous rage, but cold arms bind you. You're sealed away in a tower. Your screams fill the darkness. You feel a jolt and open your eyes to see the soul jar before you, lying still in the vault. Your hand falls from the jar and grips the pillar as you try to calm your ragged breathing.
Lucky find.
The necromancer's memories fade to black, but the feelings remain.
They may have been a necromancer, but they did not feel evil. Misguided.
No one deserves the fear and pain I felt in that vision. Not even a necromancer.
One must wonder how many more lives they took. How much misery the scum caused.
Anyone who marches at the head of an undead host deserves whatever punishment they get.
Ugh, the memories of a necromancer. What could be more vile?
The jar on the plinth before you seems ancient, but is in surprisingly good condition. The pictograms spin to life, and you're dragged into a dream. You see the lizards of the ancient empire turning their backs on you, casting you out into the wilderness. As you roam, the human apes turn away from you, all but one. One smiles, one opens his arms, one says he'll take you home. Braccus Rex. He promises power, for a price. He picks off your golden scales, one by one, stripping you down to the bone. He promised you a crown, but all you got were shackles. You try to fight, try to reclaim what's yours, but a woman takes you by the hand and leads you to a tower. He promised he'd take me home, you cry. You are home, she smiles as she seals the door. This is where you belong. Your hand drops away from the soul jar, your skin prickling. In the back of your mind, you hear a small, scared voice whimper before fading to nothing.
Nice.
The long-dead lizard's visions fade.
I can't help but sympathize with him. He just wanted to go home.
One can't help but have a bit of sympathy. Who wouldn't want to return to their home?
What he did shames his people.
No amount of loneliness excuses wickedness. He helped a monster for selfish reasons.
This is the price of pride and greed. The villain got what he deserved.
This jar glitters and, with a jerk, your mind is pulled to as the door opens and a tall, beautiful woman stalks into the room. She's flanked by heavily armed guards. You can't make out her words, but see the fear in the dwarf's eyes. The dwarf mutters a word, and the undead lurch towards the intruder, but are cut down like wheat. The dwarf tries to run, pushing her friends into the woman's path, but is grabbed before she can escape. As she's dragged away to a tower, you hear her cursing Braccus Rex and his whore. Even when she's thrown inside and the door sealed, you can still hear her shouts. You pull your hand away from the jar, your head swimming. You can feel the dwarf's cold terror still twisting in your gut.
Lucky find.
The vision fades.
She must have been acting against Braccus Rex for him to have come for her like that.
Honestly, making the dead do menial work sounds kinder than having the living do it.
Being locked in a tower was more kindness than any necromancer deserves.
Keeping the dead as slaves? What a disgusting display. She deserved every punishment she got.
Ugh, I've rarely seen such cowardice on display.
A soul jar rests between two fallen columns, emanating a faint odor of seaweed and timber.
The jar before you may have looked opulent once, but no longer. Now it's covered in grime, its paint chipped away, and its jewels long stolen. The soul jar rocks slightly, light flashing from underneath its lid. On its rim, you can just barely make out the name Gratiana. As soon as you touch the jar's cracked surface, you see a vision of splendor, silks, fine food, and decadent lechery. But underneath it all lies bone and blood. The vision shifts. You see burning villages, slaughtered women and children. You see her, purging wand in hand, standing amongst it all. She throws her head back and laughter echoes in your skull. A shadow falls across her and you see a large weeping face. She reaches out as if to comfort, but Braccus drags her back. You see her fall into the mire of the swamp, trapped. As you pull your hand away, you can feel a deep longing sadness in your soul. Is it regret or just sadness for a life that used to be?
Lucky find.
The terrible vision fades.
Gratiana's life was selfish and hedonistic. No mercy.
Whatever a person may have done in life, they can always be redeemed.
However her life began, it ended well. No one should be damned because of their youth.
Whatever a person may have done in life, they can always be redeemed.
While she lived a selfish life, she seems to have repented. She should be forgiven.
The soul jar pulses with trapped life force. When you touch the glass, your vision wavers. You emerge on the prow of a fine ship. Your armor pulses with enchantment, dominating those who draw near. Your flag flies for Braccus Rex, a tyrant who traded for your soul. With his power, your flesh and blood is no longer relevant. The vision fades as the soul thrashes, trying to sever your connection. To be soulless is a horrible, empty fate. You seek out Braccus's vault, but the moment you reach the soul jar, he ensnares you. Thus imprisoned, you can only dream about what is out of reach. Your soul, and that alluring armor. The vision shatters as the soul squirms away from you, curling up in the bottom of the jar. The soul jar pulses with trapped life force.
Good find.
The deity's head and hands are missing, severed as if by a sword. You can't tell if this was meant to be symbolic somehow, or a mere act of vandalism. As you take in its chiseled details, you have a vision. The statue comes to life and embraces you awkwardly with its broken arms. Unable to resist, you're flown away into an endless dark.
That shrine seems to have brought me here. What is this place?
Braccus, where are we?
No leaves, no trees, no soil. This is horrific!
The ethereal figure before you raises the visor of his highly polished helm. Beneath it, his handsome face is weary, yet his eyes burn fierce and bright. He glowers at you with disgust.
You pray not at my shrines. Can't say I'm surprised. You, my most wayward cub.
He spits over his shoulder, folding thick arms across his steel-bound chest.
You don't recall me, do you? I am Ralik, prime among the seven, and father of all humans. Father of you. I preferred you as a child, pious and devout, remember? I called you to follow me, and so you did.
Ralik gazes at your upright form, a contemptuous frown creasing his face.
Look at you now. My child, a killer for hire. You can't hide. I see the dead who whisper your name as they pass the threshold of the Halls of Echoes. And who's to blame? I hold anger towards the divine myself. I could tell you stories about Lucian that would turn your muzzle white, little wolf. Yet you choose to follow him. Lucian didn't make you into a mercenary, but nor did Lucian make you refuse to kill that elf in Fort Joy. Oh yes, I know about that. You're a paradox, Ifan. And who's responsible?
He stares deeply into your eyes. As you gaze into his deep green eyes, you feel your whole consciousness following. You notice every shade of stone within, from iridescent emerald to flecks of grey. The verdant pools encompass you. There is nothing else, nothing but Ralik's eyes. Suddenly, a vision coalesces. You see yourself, the bright and zealous crusader you once were. You are breathless, scouting through deep forest. You are racing with a message of utmost importance for the elven people. You make it to civilization. Too late. An explosion devastates the beating heart of the elven city. Ancestor trees thud to earth, strong trunks crack even louder than the horrified screams. A fetid miasma pulls the air. Gasping on the fumes, you are dragged to safety by a wolf who appears out of nowhere. He pulls you free, clawing an elven woman who gets in your way. She collapses, wheezing under the choking dust. She clutches your ankle with her hand, gripped tight as a vice. As you reach down to help, her hand falls away, lifeless. Through the haze, the death, you see her dead eyes, black and staring. Through her lifeless eyes, you fall. You see them, Legion. The thousands slain that day, those you were too late to save. The hundreds slain by your own hand since then. Mountains of corpses and rivers of blood. You see the motherless children left behind. The scarred slaves sold to the highest bidder. Choices you made, contracts you took. The army of the lost gaze at you silently, their loathing and reproach palpable. Encased in pitch black of deadest night, you know not which way is up and which way down. Vertigo spins your senses as you see the consequences of each choice you made, one damning choice after another. The guilt you tried to escape from lies here, bare, throbbing. It was waiting for you here all along, in this filthy chamber at the base of your rotten heart. Your pain pulses, ebbs and flows, undammed. You widen your eyes, striving to see further, but a stinging slap drags you back to reality. Ralik stands before you, gimlet eyes hard now. He slaps you again, harder.
Pity won't bring them back. Nothing can bring them back. But you can yet come back yourself. Long ago, you turned your face away from all that is light. Turn back to me, and you could yet save others. Could save all.
Ralik slaps you again, full force. He stares into your eyes with challenge.
That's what I'm looking for. That crusader courage. The courage to stand up for what's right.
Ralik punches you full in the face. You feel a familiar sensation as the delicate bones of your oft-broken nose give way. He catches your arm in one vice-like fist and dangles you above the ground. He laughs and shakes you like a rag doll. You feel rage surge within you, barely containable. Feel it electrifying the blood in your veins, pumping through you. You feel like yourself. Ralik smirks and rises to his feet, wiping your blood from his now scarlet armor.
That's it, Benmezd! That fierce spark of zeal is why I chose you, why I saved you from that sinking ship. You tried to hide it behind apathy, but the light shines through. Embrace who you really are. Why did you become a crusader in the first place? You heard my call, not Lucian's. So fight for me. I need you. The Seven didn't abandon Rivlon. We are trapped here, powerless and squabbling. You, ruthless son of humanity, you will be my champion in the world. You are my Godwoken. I will grant you my blessing, fierce wolf. It will aid you on the path out of this place. And then we will have words again.
Ralik steps towards you, solemn of face and bearing. He raises his right hand and presses it upon your heart. A surge of warmth and well-being rushes through you.
You may have noticed I've tried to help you on your journey. I blessed the water beneath your feet so that it would aid you. Now you have the power for yourself. And this is only the beginning. More and greater powers await you, if only you will seek them. Only one like you can wield them. Now go, Godwoken. Go with my blessing. Let it remind you always of who you are. My Crusader. In time, I will ask more of you. But now, your goal is simple. Survive. Escape the grasp of those who would imprison you, who would break you, who would limit your true potential, my child. You, and you alone, must rise above the reach of minor people. But before you lope away, let me ask. You are traveling with company, yes? Watch them well, then, for they are dangers as much as any magister. They are your rivals. They are Godwoken, too. But you are the one who will be a god, none other. Keep your claws sharpened and your eyes bright and keen. See everything from two sides. Take the wolf that saved you, that follows you so dutifully. Watch him. The wildest animals often turn and bite the hand that feeds them. Oh, and Losa, that pretty little one I think of at night. Kill her now, and be done with it. Until we meet again, my child. Thank you.
branches we've returned! Every second we spent in that hellish place was a second the great acorn drew closer! Interesting. You thought it was interesting, Quercus. Do you know what's interesting? Watching an entire world be strangled by the roots of doom! Seeing the giant races fall like leaves in frost! Hearing the screams of... I don't know what you're talking about! I am perfectly calm. Anyway, as interesting as that cold hellscape might have been, it does not solve our problem. We are here to stop the great acorn, not hide from it.
It's already helping more than it knows, Quercus. The fate of the world depends on our ability to research a spell to protect Rivelon. We need to travel across the land, gathering clues, experimenting with different magics, and come up with a spell to shield Rivelon from its doom. Of course, for us to do that, we must avoid being eaten by the servants of the Great Acorn. And that is where our big, foolhardy shield comes in.
Quercus! Quercus, it thinks it can use magic at our level. I don't know if that's adorable or just sad. No, I am not going to share our magic with it. I don't care how much you like it, Quercus. Very well, I cannot give it magic, but I can teach it how to forge one spell, if it will keep you happy. One.
The squirrel reaches out, touching your foot with a delicate paw, and you feel your mind open. You can see the forces of magic and see how to combine them in a new way.
There. Maybe now your pet will have a fighting chance. Yes, yes, you're welcome. But can we please get on and save the world now?
What do you want? Oh, it takes one of these to buff up, yeah. Well, nice to meet you.